Robert Ritchie. I'm the rector here at St. Patrick's Cathedral, and I would like to welcome everyone in the name of Cardinal Timothy Dolan, our Archbishop, who, as most of you would know, is currently in Rome. He attended this morning's canonization ceremony for our two new saints. He sends his love and his affection to everybody here. Each year, for the last 9 years, the Consul General of Poland and the office of the consulate made arrangements with us here at the Cathedral to have a special evening. And this year, because of the uniqueness of the occasion, the Consul General of Italy and their consulate office also are sponsoring us this evening. So all I can say is we hope to do this for many, many years. This year is different from all other years because of what happened today in Rome, but each year around this time we are very, very happy to welcome Polish consulate and all the people who come through the consulate to St. Patrick's. As you can see, we're under restoration. In 2 years, when we're back here for another celebration, hopefully much less of this or none of this here. So in Cardinal Dolan's name, I would like to say benvenuti, tutti, and vitami. Welcome, and I hope it's a beautiful concert. God bless you all.
Witam Państwa, witam wszystkich serdecznie. Good evening, dear ladies and gentlemen, honorable guests. Let me first express my gratitude to Monsignor Robert Rich for allowing us to use every year, again and again, this magnificent cathedral. And I also thank you very much, the Consul General of the Republic of Italy, Honorable Natalia Pintavaro, for all the help and assistance in organizing today's celebration. We would have to take three languages, Polish, Italian, and English. We have two popes, one is Polish and the other is Italian. And we are in New York, international community. And I understand that many tourists are coming and they are very welcome to join us. We're more than three languages. To take attention. Contemporary, just one in the sun, yeah, I'm not one people. To the sun. Nie tylko wyrażaliśmy tutaj poczucie nasze przymykanie kończy ten, ale także chcemy zachować to, co wystarczy, żeby nam się mądrzej, lepiej żyło ze sobą i na świecie. Let me remind you that John Paul II was the second longest serving Pope in modern history and the first non-Italian since Pope Adrian VI, who died in 1523. He was acclaimed as one of the most influential leaders of the 20th century, one of the most troubled world leaders in the history. His great wish to place his church at the heart of a new religious alliance that would bring together Jews, Muslims, and Christians in a great armada was present in his small pontificate and was carried on with success. Polish Pope's efforts to build bridges between the Christian and Judaism were recognized by opinion of Anti-Reformation League, which admitted that John Paul II revolutionized Catholic Jewish relation and noticed that more change for the better took place in his 27 years papacy than in the nearly 1,000 years before. Ladies and gentlemen, today is also the day when we focus on the heritage of Pope John Paul XXIII, the Catholic Church reformer and the author of numerous national speeches during his pontificate.
It's a pleasure to be with you here tonight for an event that allows us to join in the extraordinary ceremony that took place this morning in Rome, where thousands gathered to pray and rejoice. Praise for our initiative goes to my dear friend and colleague, the Consul General of Poland, Eva Dzińczyk-Jomeska. John 23rd and John Paul II left an indelible mark on the soul and conscience of our society. They were truly popes among the people and for the people. John Paul II helped to change the course of European history. history and reached the hearts of thousands of young people who today in Rome, in Poland, and throughout the world are expressing their affection and their recognition. John 23rd, who is remembered in Italy as Eva said, as the Papa Buono, the good Pope, was the architect of a real watershed in church history, convening and opening the Second Vatican Ecumenical Council. He expressed his humanity most poignantly in his famous Discorso della Luna on October 11, 1962, when, turning to all the parents and adults, he said, "Tornando a casa troverete I bambini, date una carezza ai vostri bambini e dite, questa è la carezza del Papa. Troverete qualche lacrima da asciugare, dite una parola buona. Il Papa è con noi, specialmente nelle ore della tristezza e della carezza." Which in English more or less sounds like that. "Returning home, you will find children. Give your children a caress and say, this is the caress of the Pope. You will find some tears to dry. Say a good word. The Pope is with us, especially in times of sadness and bitterness."
Può verificarsi un avvicinamento o un incontro di ordine pratico. Ieri ritenuto non opportuno o non secondo. Oggi invece lo sia o lo possa diventare domani. Decidere se tale momento è arrivato, come pure stabilire i modi e i gradi dell'eventuale consonanza di attività al raggiungimento di scopi economici, sociali, culturali, politici, onesti utili al vero bene della comunità, sono problemi che si possono risolvere soltanto con la virtù della prudenza, che la guida delle virtù che regolano la vita morale sia individuale che sociale. Perciò, da parte dei cattolici, tale decisione spetta in primo luogo a coloro che vivono o operano nei settori specifici della convivenza, in cui due problemi si pongono, sempre tuttavia in accordo con i principi del diritto naturale, con la dottrina sociale della Chiesa e con le direttive delle autorità ecclesiastiche. Non si deve infatti dimenticare che compete alla Chiesa il diritto e il dovere non solo di tutelare i principi dell'ordine etico e religioso, ma anche di intervenire autoritativamente presso i suoi figli nella sfera dell'ordine temporale, quando si tratta di giudicare dell'applicazione di quei principi ai casi concreti. Non manca animo particolarmente dotato di generosità, che trovandosi di fronte a situazioni nelle quali le esigenze della giustizia non sono soddisfatte o non lo sono in grado sufficiente, si sentono accese dal desiderio di innovare, superando con un balzo solo tutte le tappe, come volessero fare corso a qualcosa che può rassomigliare alla rivoluzione. Non si dimentichi che la gradualità è la legge della vita in tutte le sue espressioni, per cui anche nelle istituzioni umane non si riesce ad innovare verso il meglio che agendo da dentro di esse da qualmente. Non nella rivoluzione, proclama Pio XII, ma in una rivoluzione concordata sta la salvezza e la giustizia. La violenza non ha mai fatto altro che abbattere e non innalzare, accendere le passioni e non calmarle, accumulare odio e rovine, non affratellare i contendenti, e ha precipitato gli uomini e i partiti nella dura necessità di ricostruire lentamente, dopo prove dolorose, sopravvivute di la discordia.
According to an ancient fiction, with a magnificent literary expression in a novel by Enrico Cinquetis, Peter wanted to leave Rome during Nero's persecution, but the Lord intervened. He went to meet him, and Peter spoke to him and asked, "Covetus Domine, where are you going?" The Lord answered him at once, "I'm going to Rome to be crucified again." Peter went back to Rome and stayed there until his crucifixion. Yes, brothers, and sons and daughters, Rome is the see of Peter. Down the centuries, new bishops continually succeed him in his see. Today, a new bishop comes to the chair of Peter in Rome, a bishop full of trepidation, conscious of his unworthiness. And how could one not tremble before the greatness of this call and before the universal mission of this see of Rome? The see of Peter in Rome, there succeeds today a bishop who is not a Roman, a bishop who is a son of the Pope. But from this moment, he too becomes a Roman. Yes, a Roman. He is a Roman also because he is the son of a nation whose history, from its first dawning, and those thousand-year-old traditions are marked by a living, strong, unbroken, and deeply felt link in the See of Peter, a nation which has remained faithful to this See of Rome, inscrutable in the design of providence.
Przyjścia z pomocą drugiego człowieka.